thank you very much for joining today's webinar. Very interesting title, Cybersecurity Awareness during COVID-19 pandemic, even more important, but even outside pandemic is an important topic. But now we know everyone is a little bit tight on money and there's a lot more scam and a lot more guys out there that try to scam you these days. So I think it's a quite important topic. So thank you very much to Joss or HKBN Joss for running this webinar and sharing the information with us. Steven Su, yeah, he's the co-owner, managing director, and also regional head of solutions and delivery in Malaysia. He's our member, but today's speaker will be Simon Wong. He was Kapersky Regional Enterprise Solutions Leader for ASEAN 3 years, and currently he's attached to JOS since January 2019 as a Senior Manager for Cybersecurity and Network Business Development. He has 30 years of experience in the ICT industry, and he is passionate about keeping the world safer through cybersecurity enablement and knowledge sharing. That's what he is going to do today. Roughly, I think 30, 40, 45 minutes, and we will have time in the end for a Q&A, maybe another 15, 20 minutes, whatever is left. And yeah, please note your questions for yourself, or you can share it also in the chat. Well, maybe Steven, you want to also say 2-3 words before we hand over to Simon.
Hi, Patrick. Nice to meet you again. Yeah. Hi, everyone. Good afternoon. So my name is Steven Su. So I'm actually work with HKBN JOS Malaysia. So I'm actually the managing director for this company. So together with me today, I have Simon Wong, my colleague, who is the senior business development managers who are actually expert in this cybersecurity. So I hope today his sharing can actually enlighten everyone here and to take knowledge so that you can plan out your strategy. How are you going to manage the matter of cybersecurity, be it for yourself or for your own company? All right, so I will pass over to Simon. But before that, I think I want to thank Daniel Poon. So Daniel Poon, thanks to him that he actually gave me this opportunity, invite me to have this sharing together with my colleague. All right, so thank you.
Hello everyone, good afternoon. My name is Simon Wong. Let me proceed to the next page. Okay, I got to do a little bit intro on who is HKBN JOS. We are basically a system integrator. We have been operating in Malaysia since 1998, and we integrate most of the IT solutions, be it from the infra side, the servers, the data center, the cloud, the endpoint, and also from cybersecurity and also big data. Later, I will share with you a slide on the type of solutions that we implement, deploy, and even do provide consultancy for our customers. Now, the market that we serve is, we cut across. If you look at the bottom, you can see that we are in very much in the FSI, the financial services and insurance. In fact, we play in all those tier one and tier two banks, okay? And also in manufacturing, the high tech manufacturing, also all the mass manufacturing. And we also provide solution for the education sector, especially the private education, all right? The smart school and also the universities. And one thing is that during this pandemic, I think the logistics sector, the so-called supply chain segment, they are one of our key, what you call customer space. So therefore we play heavily in supply chain. The other one is that we dwell on is on the healthcare side, so the hospital side. Mainly these are all the private hospital. And what was the next slide? This is in HKBN JOS, we have about 2,200 employees that cut across 9 offices that function as a major business hub. They are mainly in China, Malaysia, Hong Kong, Macau, and Singapore. So that makes us a regional player. And then next slide is on Okay, in a nutshell, this one may look heavy, but actually it's very easy. You just look at the five icons and pillar. JAWS offers cloud computing. Basically, we help our client build their private cloud, or we can help them merge the public and the private cloud into a hybrid environment. So cloud is the in thing now. It's very much on a growing path year on year. So this takes away the headache of having to develop your own infra. Then the next piece, second pillar, let me get my laser pointer out. Where are you? Okay, there you go. Okay, this second pillar is called next gen infrastructure. The name may be frightening, next gen, but basically it's referring to the likes of infra like servers, storage, you know, your data management, and also network. Any organization, especially now when you need to deal, you know, from computer to computer or in with other companies, you need your network to be up. From the cloud into your router, into your, what you call firewall, your core switch, and all the access point. So network is fundamentally need to be implemented in any organization. Next, and one of the hot topic is cybersecurity. That is where I will come in. Cybersecurity, especially now, later on, I will share with you why during this pandemic is very, very important and very key, okay? And cybersecurity is to secure basically your system, your network, you know, in fact, to have the identity security for your staff to log in. And we also provide consultancy as regard on how to secure your infra or your environment. Next, on the digital solution, we have solution like RPA, which stands for Robotic Process Automation. Basically, this solution turns any manual work done by your staff into an automatic pace. So that will save in terms of error, in terms of timing and consistency. And then also the other part inside here that is quite important now that everyone is looking into is the what you call the data analytics. For you may say, why is it relevant to me? For example, if you are just a supermarket, you have sensor built in the IoT. So you will capture the data as in, like, for example, these certain aisles that sell cereals. When do the client customer come in, pick the most cereal at which day, which time of the day, you know, and which brand? With that, you can plan your logistics or to get in the supply so that, you know, you can fill up all the racks and, you know, optimize your business. Then the last point here is the endpoint. The endpoint is referring to what you call the devices, namely is your PC and your laptop. Now, we noticed that, you know, since the pandemic has started, there is a huge, huge demand for endpoint, especially now that a lot of companies want their staff to work from home. So they are buying up a lot. The situation has gone to the extent of even if you have money to buy the laptop, you are unable to secure supply. Okay, so it is that bad. But however, for Josh's case, is that what we do is because we have an excellent relationship with the various vendor, it could be Lenovo, Dell, Acer, Asus. So what we do is that, you know, we have this collaboration to bring in, you know, the units by the thousands. So if you guys have any requests for endpoints, you know, laptops, notebooks, please do get in touch with us so we can help you out. All right. And if you last, even at the endpoint here, sometimes when the client says, Simon, I just do need to buy, but during this period, can we rent from you? Yes, please talk to us. We have a team that does the rental business for our client. And if you look at the last arrow here, you look at it, these are predominantly our services. Okay. We have our professional services here where we help our client to deploy for projects. Okay. These are all engineers. That's why 70% of our workforce is on technical related. That is where you need the resources to come in. And then, of course, when you buy the equipment from us, you need to ensure that they are working in tip-top condition. That's where we offer the hardware and software maintenance. So we make sure your equipment is in tip-top condition so that at night you can sleep soundly, knowing the fact is that your infra is running, all right? And of course, there's another piece on manpower outsource. Basically, some organization, they just don't want to go to the hassle of hiring someone. So they say, Josh, can you supply me with me an IT executive who can do network? Yeah, we can do that. So talk to us. And then there are also customers who come to us. Say, hey, Simon, I don't want, my forte is in manufacturing. I don't want to bother about IT. Can I outsource the entire thing as a managed services to you? Yes, by all means, talk to us. So if you need to have all these solutions, yeah, come to Josh and we can help you out. We are definitely a very competent IT advisor. So let me go on to the next. I'm sure you all have met me for the first time today. And who is Simon Wong? You see this handsome guy? Actually, he's not young. He's 54 years old this Friday. And a little bit about me is that, as mentioned by Patrick earlier, I was with Kapaski as the regional enterprise solution sales leader for Southeast Asia. So this is a heavy traveling job almost by the week. And currently I'm with HKBN Joss as the senior manager for cybersecurity and networking business since January 2019. And I have about 30 plus years experience in ICT, but it was in cybersecurity that I find my forte, that led me to my passion. So I'm driven by the fact is that there are so many malware in the world. So, and I wanted to help keep the world safer place to nourish sharing on cybersecurity. So today I will talk about that. Next, the agenda. This is a specially craft class, especially for BOC, after consulting with Steven and also Daniel and Patrick. So first thing is on the agenda is I want to share with y'all the threat landscape, okay, an overview of the threat landscape, all right, especially during this pandemic, so that you guys are aware, you know, what are they and know where we are now. Then after that, I will share with you what are the different types of cyber attacks that have occurred, okay? And thirdly, I will also talk a little bit on what is the best industry practice to secure your environment, all right? Then lastly, I will also talk about what are the do and don'ts, and also a slide on tips for those working from home, okay? So then after that, we will go on to a Q&A. So I think I'm a bit running behind schedule. Okay, firstly, just look at this diagram. It's a slightly blur, but it's okay. This is a global threat report for Sonic War that was published this year on last year global cyber attack trends, okay? Just look at this, the third pillar. If you look at it, look at the number, 4.8 trillion intrusion attempts was made last year. Now, can anyone tell me how many zeros are there inside 4.8 trillion intrusion attempt? The last, I think, the count was about 11 zeros. So this is a huge, huge, what you call evidence to show that, you know, the cyber criminals are highly active to try to make penetration into a lot of organization, whether the organization or individuals. And the next pillar I want you to look at is the fifth pillar. If you look at it, ransomware. Ransomware has gone up by 62% to about 300, almost 5 million. Now, this ransomware is deadly is because this is how cyber criminals earn their pay. Okay. So in a nutshell, this slide tells you in 1 year, the number of attacks, different types of what has gone up. Okay, and you look at the sixth one, the IoT, this is the Internet of Things attacks. Now, a lot of people don't understand is that they ask me, Simon, what is IoT? Okay, Internet of Things, it can be anything. Let's say, assuming you're in a house, all right, you use a software to control, to turn on your aircon, to turn on your rice cooker, to turn on your, you know, your gas to heat up your food. Those things that is devices that are connected to the internet, okay, they are known as IoT. And most of the time, these so-called small devices, they don't have a lot of protection. Okay, they don't have protection namely. So what hackers do is that they will use these devices to turn them into an army to attack certain website where they will create what you call the denial of service to that portal or to the company. So later on, I will explain more in the subsequent slide. Let's move on. Okay, this one is basically, since the pandemic started, these are examples of what you call the electronic crime teams that was crafted by this cyber criminal. And of course, the top one is that they will craft something to exploit the people fear of not knowing enough. You know, there are people who are out there looking for info on disease tracking, testing, and also what you call the treatment for COVID-19. So later I will share with you some of the samples. Then of course, the next thing is that they try to impersonate medical bodies like the World Health Organization, Central for Disease Control, US. And in fact, the respective country ministries of Ministry of Health, okay, to mimic them and inject the so-called malware inside. Okay, the next one is that they are also what you call fake financial assistance or government stimulus packages being what you call address has this front, but actually behind they have malicious intent. And the next one is that there are a lot of scams. Okay, basically when people are looking for better protection, so there are a lot of scams that offer, you know, PPE, personal protection equipment. But when you click on it, they may have what you call injected with a malware that can go into your device or into your network. So those are the things that we have seen, and majority are related to this so-called five topics, all right, during this pandemic. Now, let's move on. Okay, this is a statistic that was from Trend Micro that was published on the second half of 2020. If you look at the left side, there are two bars, the red one and the blue. So you need to combine these two to really have total. EMEA stands for Europe, Middle East, and Africa. If you look at it here, this is for the first 3 months from January to March of 2020, which means it's at the early stage of the COVID-19 infection. Already there is high numbers of malicious attack on the global scale. And what is related to us is more on the APEC. APEC one is looking at about 50,000 cases, okay? So if I drill down to what do you call Asia, India has the highest, yeah, almost like 20,000 cases. This is all within the first 3 months of last year. So where the COVID-19 is still at the beginning stage. After that, it went up the roof, okay? So our neighbor, Indonesia, also got almost about 9K cases. Just 3 months only. This shows that at the beginning is already so high. What happened during the height of the COVID is even a lot more. So all these statistics is not done by me, but it's all compiled from various sources, from Sonic War, Trend Micro, and all the competent authorities in this. Let me go to the next slide. Okay, now I shared with you just now was the different teams during COVID. Now, this is one example. If you look at it, you know, they were targeting people who was wanted to know more about the COVID-19 spread, the map, and they inject this kind of a malware behind an attachment. So this is one sample. They do that malware spreading or infection. Second, if you look at this, this was especially targeted at Japanese. Okay, now Imhotep is named after the Egypt king. Okay, and Imhotep is basically a what do you call a malware? How they did it is very unique. They do it is it's like the published like article. Okay, then they say yes, COVID-19, all this thing, and they say for those who wants to know more information about this COVID-19. And then you can go into this link and they put down there, you see the word in Japanese. So a lot of Japanese, you know, their English may not be there, but they prefer something to read in Japanese. So this is how they con them. they put it in Japanese. The minute you click here, you're actually downloading the malware into your laptop. So this is how dangerous it is. Now, the third one here, you look at it, this is a hospital basically in Czech. They were doing a lot of testing. They kena ransomware. So all the customer patients, the data was locked, including the result. They had no choice. They had to pay to get back the data. So, you know, cyber criminals, they don't have what you call the Chinese call yanzing, the humanistic part of them. So, you know, they just whack. They don't care. This is the real thing is you're seeing here. And last one was basically, you know, during the whole of last year, there were a lot of domains that came out related to COVID-19. So this is very, very scary when it comes to this, what you call COVID malware attacks, because the cyber criminals will use whatever is the latest and hottest trending to entice people and to entrap people falling to their tricks. Next is that, okay, I want to talk about, you know, what are some sample, how they con people to click on into emails. This is a typical email phishing attack. Now, let me take it up all here. Okay, now, for example, let's say my email is simonwong@joss.com. Okay, how many of you do you really read the domain name? Okay, for example, let's say this is jsmith@acme.com. Okay, this may be a legit email. Okay, but a lot of times, how the criminal did it is they will put there jsmith@acme dot maybe something in between pz.com. For a glance, you guys might think that this is a legit, but actually it's not, because acme.com and acme.pz.com is two different domain names. That's why there is a lot of attack from the domain names. In a study that was done, I think the statistics done, out of every 10 cases, 4 is related to domain name cyber attack. So when you read your email, please check the sender. Do you know the sender first? Yes. Then you check the email. Is it the correct email? If you are not sure, how what you do? You call this guy, John, and say, John, did you send me an email regarding this at this time? If John say yes, then you know it's legit. If John say no, then you know the obvious answer. So just be careful. And then the other thing is also, later on, I will share with you why you shouldn't read your email late at night and also when you're tired. This is where our gut is down and we get easily click on the wrong website. All right. Now, next is ransomware. I need to talk about this because this is the most dangerous things of the malware that is happening throughout the world today. What is ransomware? Ransomware is a type of ever-changing malware that basically lock away your files on your laptop, on your server. Thereby, you are unable to access them. Until a ransom is paid, then they will release, they will give you a code to decrypt so that you can access your file. Hence the word ransomware. Okay. Now, okay, let me share with you some facts on ransomware. This is, I think, last year's numbers. About 71% of ransomware were targeted at the businesses. The rest are all more on the individual scale. So they will pinpoint businesses that are vulnerable and they target them for ransomware attack. Now, the highest ransomware demanded was USD 70 million, okay, by the ransomware call review. This happened recently, in fact, this month on 4th of July, then they were targeted at the Kasewa customer. Kasewa is a service provider to multi ISP and MSP. They are all the so-called the internet service provider and the managed service provider, which in turn hold millions of customers. So whether Kasewa pay or not, we do not know, because this thing normally they don't disclose until such time that they can do so. And if you look at the next line, the highest ever ransom paid was 4.5 million. by CWD Global, Global. This is a travel agency that have a lot of customer data, and because they lock it away, the client cannot book flights and all those things. And this happened last year, July 20, and they actually paid $4.5 million. Okay, this is one case. If there are many cases combined, it's a lucrative business to be in. Now, it takes only 3 seconds for a ransomware to start encrypting your file. It's like, yep, yi sam, that's it. Okay. Now, the next thing is, question that, you know, I want to ask you, can ransomware infect your mobile phone? Okay, think about it. Let me know during the Q&A. That's your homework. Okay, let me share with you, draw down here. Okay, these are some of the examples of the ransomware that had occurred the last 3 years, okay? It used to be in Asia, the highest paid ransom was $1.14 million by a Korean internet service provider, because the ransomware locked about 153 of their web hosting servers. Now, this is another slide with more information on ransomware. If you look at this year in Asia Pacific, the highest ransomware paid was by a Korean web hosting firm. They paid about $1.14 million. That was about almost 4 years ago, which affected 153 of their servers by this ransomware called Erebus. All right. So there you go, already in excess of 1 million 4 years ago. The worst thing was that, you know, there was a cancer patient cancer hospital in Jakarta, which they have their patient medical records and holding lockup by WannaCry. WannaCry is very deadly, is because it was developed using a next generation hacking tools. The hacking tool is known as Eternal Blue, and this Eternal Blue originally belongs to the CIA, okay? And it was compromised and leaked out to the World Wide Web, meaning to the rest of the world. You can check this info in what you call WikiLeaks. You go into Ward 7, they have a lot of information on WannaCry. So really, this ransomware can make people cry. Now, this is in the US Colonial Pipeline, just only about 2 months ago, where the ransomware DarkSide is from Russia. They practically hold up the fuel distribution throughout the west coast of the United States. So they paid about 4.4 million ransom. This is probably the second highest ransom ever paid. And this ransom paid is not in dollar and cent. They paid in cryptocurrency, normally bitcoins. Why bitcoins? Because bitcoins, once you do it, you cannot trace. It's untraceable. That's the reason why cyber criminals prefer this money to be paid in bitcoins. Now, if you look at it, 3 years ago, approximately 39% of the ransomware victim pay the ransom. Okay, then 2019, the number rose to 45%. Last year, it was estimate about 58%. Okay, so what does it tell us? Ransomware is a very lucrative business, okay? And cyber criminal will try their means to top up on this so-called business line. Let me go on. Okay, the different types of cyber attacks. Basically, I list down here about 7, okay, that you need to be aware of. Malware, it consists of actually 2 words. It is taken from malicious software. So in short, they call it malware. All right. Now here, malware is, I give you some examples. Some of these, Petya is a ransomware, crypto locker, the word really mentioned here, locker, so it's a ransomware. Non-Petya is a destroyer, it's not a ransomware, it mimic Petya. Okay. WannaCry, ransomware, and Stuxnet. Now, the reason why I select this few I want to share with you is, Petya and CryptoLocker are ransomware. CryptoLocker is considered the deadliest because of its ability to even lock, and they can stay there for a long time. All right. So you need to do, if you got CryptoLocker, you probably need to reformat everything and backup from your backup source. Non-Petya is a malware that was developed by the Russian military to basically attack or downgrade a country by the name of Ukraine. Remember when they were having a war over Crimea? So this was the intent of this malware called NonPetya. It mimicked Petya, but it's not a ransomware like Petya. It is a destroyer. 30 minutes, NonPetya landed in Ukraine. A hospital in Boston was affected with NonPetya. Now, NonPetya, biggest victim was Maersk, M-A-E-R-S-K, the world's largest shipping line. Maersk network was down for 2 weeks. Their ship cannot function for 2 weeks. In these 2 weeks, they lost millions of business of their network down. Because all those ships need to be communicating with the HQ. And NonPetya practically put them on standstill for 15 days until they can restore fully. Not even fully, almost something to recover to start with. Right? WannaCry is deadly is because within 2 weeks, it almost infected about 150 million cases. So this is known as what you call the next-gen ransomware. They was developed using the Eternal Blue hacking tools. There was one owned by state-sponsored agency. Now, the last one, I leave the best for the last, Stuxnet. A lot of people say, Simon, what is so special about Stuxnet? Stuxnet is the first, what you call cyber nuclear malware. They were designed specifically to target at the Iranian nuclear reactor. We all know the nuclear reactor used in Iran is for electricity purposes. So during the fusion of the atom, a lot of heat comes out. So they need water cooling to cool it down. What this malware done was to shut down the water cooling. So how I know about this is because, in Iran, they ask Russia for help. So that's where Kaspersky comes in. That's how I know a lot about this Stuxnet. So it was the world's first cyber nuclear malware. Very potentially could be very deadly. And you look at it, phishing. Now, this phishing is the same as term as phishing, F-I-S-H-I-N-G. When we are young, our parent or our father or our grandfather bring us to the lake to fish. We have a rod and a string, and at the end of the rod, we have a hook, we tie a bait, and hopefully to get a fish. This is the same concept. They craft an email that has some interest for the recipient, hoping that the recipient will click on it so that he can get hooked, right? Now, one of the latest method is you call drive-by download. Okay, drive-by download meaning what? Let's say if you look at my laser pointer, I just pass by this icon. I don't have to click on it. I'm already infected. That's why they call it drive-by download. You just move across this icon, you can now already. So this is the very advanced kind of malware attack. You have to be careful. That's why check always the domain name. Now, fourth one is the man in the middle attack. What it does is that, let's say I'm sending an email to Daniel while he's in transit, someone attack in the middle. This is called man in the middle attack, okay? That's why email, we always tell our client to encrypt the email. Okay, so that when the intended recipient receive it, he has the decoder to decode it because he is the right recipient. So that to prevent people from attacking in the middle, the man in the middle attack. Okay, the other one very common is password attack, meaning they will try to make attempts to predict your password. So your password need to be very strongly formulated. I will share with you afterward some of the ideas on how to create a strong password. Because a lot of times people want to take it easy, they just put password. Until today, we have system administrators still use password 123, password 0123. Same thing, because they make their life easy, they also make their life easy for cyber criminal to come in. All right. Now, earlier on, I talked about IoT, using the IoT to do a DDoS. Okay, DDoS is basically denial of service attack. What it does is, let's say you have an online portal to do business. So cyber criminal wants to, you know, divert the business from your portal. They will instruct all the IoT to attack you, meaning they will fully load your portal until you cannot cope, is down, or they will divert the traffic to another portal. So this kind of thing can also happen. Back in Chinese New Year 2017 or 18, Telecom Malaysia, that February month, I still remember, a lot of unified StreamX have problem. Why? Because Telecom was targeted for DDoS. So that's why it impact their ability to respond to genuine customer. All right. And last one is about malwaretizing. Basically, it's also two words, is about malware advertising. All right. So you see sometimes when you're on a computer, all of a sudden certain things pop up. You know, all these advertising ads and all those things. One. Why? They are already inside your net, your endpoint. So that's why it can keep popping out. So you need to do a cleanup, you know, run a diagnostic on your antivirus. That one can be mitigated through using your antivirus to clean up. All right. I think during Q&A, you can ask for more things about how to do these things, clean up. Okay, this one, very interesting. I like this guy. His name is Mr. Robert Mueller, the third. He came up with this famous phrase. There are only two types of companies. Those that have been hacked and those that will be hacked. What does it tell you? He said, no company is ever secure. Okay, basically, he's saying that. So make sure your security layers are well encased. Thank you, Mr. Robert. Okay, the next one is the so-called golden triangle. Now, this is the technology triad. Okay, basically, among the three things here, you got people, process, and technology. Every company has. The weakest link is the human factor. Okay. So human are the one that contribute to all those security breaches. It's a well-known fact. So therefore, you have to ensure that your staff or your employee need to have certain level of cybersecurity awareness on what to do. And when they face with a certain, you know, environment whereby they think this is not right, especially emails that may be deemed as phishing. So they need to know about this. Okay, the other thing is that I mentioned earlier on, you know, don't check your emails late at night and when you're tired. This is from my own experience, because Hong Kong Broadband Network, the IT security department does a monthly phishing email test, which means they craft certain email, okay, to all the employees. And then they will see which employees, or we call our employees talents, will click on it. Then they will give a report. The following are the talents who click on this phishing email test. In HKBN, we take it very serious. If you fail the phishing test, meaning you click on it, you will be issued the first yellow card. If you get two yellow cards, which is equal to a red card, like exactly like football, what will happen is you will get a call by your boss to attend a cybersecurity awareness. And for that year, you may forego your bonus or your increment. That is how serious HKBN takes what you call cybersecurity awareness too. So do that bear in mind. Now back to this, why I say you don't check your email at night and when you're tired. This is for my personal experience, because there was one time there was a phishing test that came in. I read my email. It was for our group CEO called Nick Lai. And Nick every day practically sent out email. So we thought it was normal. And then it was 11:36 p.m. I know the time because it's encased into my mind. And I was tired, you know, and basically, when we at night and tired, our guard is down. So try not to read that. And I click on it. Lucky that, you know, the email that came in the phishing test was at nick.lai@hkbn.pz.com. I failed to notice the additional .pz there. So that was the phishing test that I failed. Even for people of my, you know, awareness that is very high in cybersecurity. So therefore, I always tell people in my masterclass on cybersecurity, do not check your email late at night and when you are tired, because that's where you can make mistakes. All right. Next. Okay, because the audience is a mix, so I came up with this slide especially for SMB, okay, on why is SMB business is more vulnerable to cyber attacks. Okay, first thing is the successful rate of penetration by cyber criminal is very high for SMB. Okay, SMB is seen as an easy prey. Why? Typically, because SME will spend less in security, so therefore equals to less protection. All right. Now, the cost of buying a ransomware ready made from the dark web is very low. So cyber criminals tend to do that because they have a low investment, but potentially a lucrative return. That's why they want to indulge in ransomware. All right. So like what I say, it is a very high margin business for cyber criminals, but not for people like us. Okay. Now, the SMB sector is usually they don't invest also heavily in IT resources. So when they kena the ransomware, they also would not know what to do. A lot of times I get calls from my account manager, say, Simon, my client is infected with ransomware, what should I do? I say the first thing is you isolate the device, the server or the endpoint. Do not let it connect to the network or the internet. Shut it down, okay? Because you need to isolate it. Then we will come in to help you clean it up. Unless you know how to clean up, good, better still, do it. Okay, now, the human being is that we always have the notion that it won't happen to me. Okay, now, this is what you call the best industry practices to secure your cybersecurity. First thing is that this is meant for generally for companies, not more for individuals, but the first step is to develop a cybersecurity policy. Okay, the reason why an organization need to do this to develop a cybersecurity policy is that so that all your employee or all your talents are aware, okay, on what to do in case there is a breach, all right, and who to report to. And there are what you call SOP in place. So you anticipate the problem first before it happens. Therefore, you need to have a sound cybersecurity policy, okay? And then second point, you conduct a cybersecurity assessment because this should be done on an annual basis. The reason being is, it used to be the notion of what I don't know would not harm me. But in cybersecurity term, what you don't know may harm you. Because why? The malware may sit inside your network for years without you knowing and siphoning out all your important data. Okay? So you need to do a cybersecurity assessment, preferably annual basis, so that you know where is your security posture. And then from the assessment, we know there is a gap, okay? You need to map back this posture gap to an acceptable level so that you can function or conduct a proper penetration test. That's why we always advise the client to do a cybersecurity assessment first before you do a penetration test, right? Because a pen test done without a cybersecurity assessment to know your posture, it may even affect your production or your network. All right. Now, third one, invest in the firewall. Why? Because firewall is your first line of defense. If you look at a topology of an organization, from the cloud, the traffic comes in to your router will go into your DMZ, which is your firewall. That is your first line of defense before connecting to your core switch and the distributed switch to the rest of the endpoint. Now, in case where you cannot ransomware, very important that you must have your backup, which is number 4. Backup your data. The reason why you need to backup your data is very obvious. If ransomware comes in, they lock your files. Okay, you need to restore your data from your backup. That's why backup is important. In fact, they will tell you to do it three times. First thing is you backup into your local. Okay, this advice can be used for individual and also corporate, all right? First, backup copy in your local, backup copy into your data center or your DC, so to say. And then of course, one, maybe if you are working from home, save it into your thumb and detach it. So your thumb is an external device. For company, you may want to consider the tapes, okay? Why? Once they save it, the tapes is off. They are not connected to the network. Because the latest ransomware, this is how they work. First, they attack your file into your server or your device. The second step they do is they will look for your backup and they will lock up your backup. So therefore, leaving you zero chance to even restore your backup. That's why we always tell our customer now, have an external copy that is not connected to your network for your backup solution. So these are the things that we consistently advise our client to do it, you know, because this one, yeah, it may be a bit tedious, but if let's say a ransomware attack and they hold or they a lot of your data or financial data, you got no means to recover, then you might have to pay. But with a good backup, you know, for example, the backup you do it like daily basis, at least your data loss is probably on the day itself, you know. So you won't lose too much so that you can restore back majority of your data. And the fifth thing is use two-factor authentication or multi-factor authentication. What does it mean? Very simple. Now, 2FA, I think most of you got Maybank to you and CIMB to you. First, you log in to this M to you. You key in your ID and you key in your password. That will be the first stage. Now, when you do a transaction, you want to transfer money to Daniel, okay, for BOC membership. So they will prompt you for a token, okay? This token is known as two-factor authentication, okay? Now, more business are moving on top of 2FA to MFA, multi-factor authentication. What it does is that, you know, there can be have like thumb scanning, retina scanning, you know, all those biometrics scanning to authenticate this person is genuine on top of the 2FA. That's why they call it multi-factor authentication. All right. Even like if you're home, you have your email. It's good that, you know, in your desktop, you have email, you activate the authenticator 2FA to your handphone. So when the desktop challenges you with the 2FA, you go to your handphone, get the 6-digit code you key in. The idea is the desktop and your phone is separate. So it's most unlikely the cyber criminal will hack into two devices at the same time. Two-factor authentication, the 6-digit code is only valid for 30 seconds. So it is quite challenging for any cyber criminal to hack in within a short time. The other thing is number 6 is have stringent password. Okay, this one I think I'll talk more after this. And 7 is that, you know, you should update your operating system and software application when there are available patches, okay? This will include your phone, your smartphone, whether you're Android or you're iPhones. Regularly, they will have what you call OS update. Please update it because this OS update, they will have security features to patch back whatever vulnerability found before that. So it's important to update it, especially like, you know, your Microsoft, you'll probably have to do it every month, okay? And then of course, if you're using an endpoint or laptop, please install a good anti-malware or antivirus into your devices, all right? And then the last one is, you know, if you're a business, you know, invest a bit on creating cybersecurity awareness for your employees. Because, you know, if you look at it, your employee size, your IT is only very small percentage. The majority are non-IT people, so they may not be aware of cybersecurity, what to do, what not to do. So do have this kind of awareness campaign for them, you know. So to say that. Okay, next is, hold on, what is next? Okay, the do and don'ts. Okay, let me start off with the don't. Okay, the X. Okay, the X. Now this one apply for both corporate and also individual. Okay, very much individual. Let me start off first. Now, if you're at a cafe, try not to use the free Wi-Fi at a cafe. Okay, the reason, especially if you want to do business transaction, meaning you want to do money transfer, anything to do lah, with business like trading and all those things, do not use free Wi-Fi at these public places, cafe, hotel, or public venues. The reason being is they are public Wi-Fi. The security level at this spot is low. It's very easy to hack in. Even a person like me also can hack in. Okay? So, best advice is, if you need to start at Starbucks, you know, don't use it to go and do money transfer at your my bank to you, to your wife lah, or to Daniel for the BOC fees. Okay. Always go into a secure Wi-Fi. Secure Wi-Fi means either your corporate Wi-Fi or your at-home Wi-Fi. Okay. Very important, huh? Now the other thing is that don't leave sensitive info lying around the office. Now, it may look common sense, okay, but until today, we have people writing down their password on a piece of paper and they tape it on the table so that they don't forget, okay? And I think recently, as back in November when I was in Asunta Hospital for my left arm injury, I went there on the emergency ward. On the table, I saw, you know, a nicely taped piece of paper. Password is what I say. Immediately I told the nurse, I said, you shouldn't put it that list. Any guy who take it, I take a picture, I can easily hack in already. So those are the things that, you know, we shouldn't do lah. Don't write down your password lah. And then of course, social media is a great site for personal information, because some people accidentally, or I don't know, accidentally or intentionally publish their life on the net, you know, where they will share the private information. So don't do that. For example, let's say, if let's say this is a true story, this lady, she published, you know, on the social media that she's going for this vacation when and when and when. Kebetulan people found out where she stay. They broke into her home. So why ask for trouble? So try not to publish your personal data on the social website. And the fourthly is that don't click on links for unknown source. If you do not know who is the sender, just don't click on the attachment. All right? Play safe. It's no lost one. And the other thing is that, you know, this is very important. Don't leave your devices unattended. For example, say, Simon, I leave my laptop in the office. How? I say very simple. What you do is you make sure your laptop is secured through the cable. They're tied to something permanent so that they cannot take away. Second thing is, do not let your laptop open as in sense that your email can be seen. What you do is you lock your laptop, control, alternate, delete, lock it. So when you go out for lunch, you come back, you just key in your password. Otherwise, people will use your email to, could be so many things. They send a nasty email to the boss, say, you know, you're stupid or what. Then your boss thinks it's you. But how you didn't do it. So please pay attention. Do not leave your laptop unattended. That is what is meant. Okay? Now, next is the do. The do is, like I said just now earlier, use secure Wi-Fi, okay? Either from home or your office, all right? If you're doing it from your home, make sure you invest in a VPN, okay? VPN is basically a layer of protection to prevent man-in-the-middle attack, all right? Now, second one, this is where I get asked a lot of times. Simon, how do I create a strong password? Now, my advice to you is, your password should be a minimum of 10 characters, okay? And you should use uppercase, lowercase, numerics, and special, what you call the sign, the hash sign or the dollar sign. For example, I give you here. You see, you start off hash, and then you have a uppercase, Porsche, Mecca, Meccan, 2021. You have numbers, and then you have the dollar sign. So it fulfills the character, the four criteria. You need to have uppercase, lowercase, numbers, and special character. As long as you got these four and minimum 10 characters long, it's a bit challenging for cyber criminal to guess your password. Or you can use what you call pass faces. What you mean by pass faces is very simple. For the gentleman or men who are married, you know, you just can put lah, you know, something like my mother-in-law birthday is on 12th November. It's a phrase, but you can remember. Or you can say, my mother-in-law name is Lachmi. Okay? I know most men would disagree with me. Why put M-I-L? You know, mother-in-law. Is it cyber criminal will not expect you to remember your mother-in-law. Well, so to say, this is a joke, huh? Not applicable for everyone. Then the next thing is that, you know, do pay attention to phishing traps in email and signs of scam. Okay, like I earlier said on, look at the domain name. Okay, make sure the sender is, you know who he is. You are not sure, just call the guy, ask, did you send me an email? Just to verify, one call only. Then you know already for sure whether he or she could send you an email. All right. Then the next one is when you want to destroy data, you do it properly and completely. Okay. Why completely? Because, for example, I give you an example. We all now work from home, right? We do a lot of online shopping, Shopee, Lazada, you know, Zalora. Then when the parcel came to you, okay, you, there is a delivery note in front. You have your name, your phone number, and your address. All those are your personal data. Okay. And when you take it out, make sure you shred it before you throw away in the dustbin. Because we have criminals who scout the bin for this kind of data. Because why? Once they know your name, they know your address, they know your phone, they can create, carve out certain things to even rob you. Okay, and they may call you. Okay, hey, this is a hospital, no? Your mother fall ill. You have to come now for payment. So you panic, you come out of your house. So when you come out of your house is empty. That's where they can rob you. So do pay attention to this kind of thing. When you want to destroy this kind of shit, make sure it's complete. Shred it or cut it up, right? Lastly, be aware of your surrounding. Why I say that? Because this is a true thing. I was at a coffee bean and I was looking at this guy. Why is this guy taking a so-called, what they call the GoPro, was like as if he's doing a selfie. Actually, he is not. He is actually recording those people using laptop who are doing some kind of transaction. He can capture the keystroke. Because why? The camera can zoom in. So be aware of these kind of people, you know, in surrounding you. You know? You just don't know. Don't assume that he's taking a selfie. It may not be. Okay? So do pay attention to your surrounding. All right? Next. Oh, I'm running behind a bit time. Okay, this is a slide that I created for those who are working from home. Okay? So let me run this through. First thing is make sure your laptop or your personal computer have a strong antivirus. Don't download those who are free antivirus. Why? Very simple. Because free antivirus do not have the key features that will protect your laptop. Always go for a paid copy, right? And you can buy it from the website. You can even buy it from Shopee or Lazada, you know, for a legit copy, right? Second thing is, add another layer of authentication. Put in the 2FA or MFA to your laptop if when you're working from home. So it may be a bit, you know, more step for you to go in, but for long term, you are more secured. All right. So that's the reason why we do it. For my email, my 2FA is on my phone. So when I go into my private email, they will challenge me with a 6-digit code where I need to refer back to the 2FA on my phone to key in. So they are two separate devices. Now, as I mentioned earlier, make sure your Windows OS is updated. Okay, that goes the same for your smartphone. The reason being is the updated patches contain security update that will add in a layer of protection for whatever vulnerability is found for the version before the latest. Okay, so it's important. Now, the other thing is home Wi-Fi. All home Wi-Fi, you need to secure it with password. So make sure you put in what I call just now, I shared with you earlier, at least a 10-digit long password. Have the uppercase, lowercase, numbers, and special characters. Okay, don't be lazy. Just put in password 123. Very easy hack one. Because why? When you go to Google, you search, what are the common password mistake people make? Then they will list down, I tell you, the top 20 password people use. Very easy one. You just try any of these, you can go through already. So make sure you formulate a strong password for your home Wi-Fi. Okay, the other thing is, if you're working from home, you know, your personal device, you should invest in a good virtual private network. Like I said earlier, your VPN basically provide and cast a soft, a safe tunnel when you connected to the World Wide Web, right? Now, for my last master class, some client asked me what are the example of a good VPN. So I have list down here, Express VPN, 9.9 rating out of 10. This is what I did. Then Surfshark 9.8 and Nord VPN 9.1. I personally use Nord VPN 9.1. For certain reason, maybe we can discuss this during Q&A. Okay, conclusion. This will be my last slide. And cybersecurity protection and awareness is a culture from top down. Okay, this is especially true for organization, meaning from the CEO and all those things. Okay, now the cybersecurity policy applies to every member of the organization, including the CEO. Let's say you have a cybersecurity policy whereby the person who requests for payment cannot be the same person who approves. This goes for the same for the CEO. Just because you think you are a CEO, you don't go and send a note to your finance, I request, I authorize. Because if you are doing that, the cyber criminal will find out, they will mimic you to put in a request and they also approve at the same time. We have seen cases of this happening before. So let's try to be smarter. The person who requests cannot be the same person who approves. It must be two separate parties, okay? Now, one thing is that how do you know you're secured? You can do that by having a regular review on your security posture, meaning an assessment done on your company on a regular basis. You could do it once a year, but make sure it's done properly, right? Okay, I think the fourth one is very important. I think I mentioned countless of time, update your cybersecurity knowledge. Just one class alone would not be enough. The reason being is because as technology evolves, so will the cyber criminals' methods of compromise. So you need to be updated with cybersecurity knowledge. It is one of the areas that, you know, constantly evolving and changing, and there are many solutions coming out of the market to address this kind of constant threat from the market space. Lastly, I bring you to the kitchen. You take out a full onion, you cut it into half. What do you see? Half onion. Your cybersecurity protection, it should be like an onion. You're in the core, you have multiple layers to protect yourself. Of course, the more layers you have, the more rigid it is. But you need to balance it. How many layers you want to secure your environment? It also depends on your business. All right? I think that's all for me. Daniel, Patrick, hand over back to you.
He took away the prophet's dream for a prophet on the street. Now she's stronger than you know. A heart of steel starts to grow. All his life he's been told he'll be nothing when he's old. All the kicks and all the blows, he won't ever let it show. 'Cause he's stronger than you know. A heart of steel starts to grow. When you've been fighting for it all your life, you've been struggling to make things right. That's how a superhuman learns to fly.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Simon. I think quite complete and quite comprehensive, very insightful. Thanks a lot for sharing that. And but I would just open it to anyone. So if you have any questions to Simon or Steven, please just unmute and ask your question directly. Or
you can also hi, Patrick. Hi, Simon. Yeah. This is hi. Fabian. Fabian Ong. I want to ask quickly because I got something to go off soon. Okay. Simon, thank you for all the presentations. It was very, very insightful. I got one question is regarding, so since you have cybersecurity, such a, you know, there are many out there keep on evolving. So how do we protect ourselves? I mean, like how frequent do we need to, you know, understand all this malware, maliciousware? Because I mean, I don't have an IT team just to look for this, right? So as a SME, how what do you suggest? I mean, does your company offer this service or how?
Yes, yes. What we do is that, okay, there are a few things you can do. If let's say you don't want the hassle of managing your infra, you can outsource it entirely to JOS. We will take it A to Z, all right? Mm. So we make sure that your infra is up to date with patches, the OS, so that you know you just focus on your business. The rest, IT, we can help you set up. Because the knowledge is that, you know, how frequent, that will be a bit challenging because every day things happen. So like for me, what I do is I subscribe to a number of what they call cybersecurity forum. So when they have these latest things, for example, just now I show you one slide on the what they call the ransomware, the biggest ransomware demanded 70 million. By Rebel, the ransomware. It happened on 4th of July. It's only when? About less than 2 weeks ago. So these are the updates that I get when I subscribe to certain forum. So that we know what is the latest attack, you know, what are kind of different malware in the market. So that way we can have some knowledge. You know,
okay, another question, a very quick one. So let's think about worst case scenario. Is there like a company or insurance that we can buy just in case, you know, things go south or something like that? I mean, is there something like that?
Yeah, I heard that they are in the market. They are maybe, I'm not sure which company, but in the US, they have insurance company that offer cybersecurity protection insurance, you know. So you pay a certain premium, you get protected for in case you are being breached. Okay, especially in Europe, where they have to comply with the General Data Protection Regulation, GDPR. Okay, they buy insurance to safeguard it. Okay, so you may want to check with your local insurer that whether do they have that. I heard Malaysia is starting to have this, but I'm not sure exactly who. You know, maybe you can ask your local your insurance agent. Any insurance agent here?
Yeah, I'm an insurance broker. Okay, I thought insurance is those Malaysian one, mostly life insurance, medical insurance, general insurance for house, but cybersecurity like that also got.
We have a cybersecurity division.
I see. Okay. Yeah, maybe
we can call later check.
Okay. Maybe Daniel, we can check the information for Simon and Patiban on the online. Maybe after that, we can call each other.
Yeah, sure.
Right. By the way, Fabian, just that you know, Biz on Calls is a business platform. Yeah. So our insurance people who are here, they are not necessarily selling just live, because live is everywhere.
No, no, it was just a joke. I mean, I know. I really
we tailor for business. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Guys, I need to go. Okay. Thank you very much.
Okay. Bye, bye,
bye. Bye-bye. Hopefully we can play golf again. Yeah.
I got a question for Simon.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. You see, how safe is it? Is it for us to leave our credit cards on, let's say, shopping website like Shopee and whatnot? Very often they ask us to save. We say no, we don't want to save. But sometimes because we buy often, we save it there. How sure are we that such information and data will not get out? You know.
Okay. First thing, very simple. For those company that want to hold customer information such as credit card, you can ask them, are you PCI DSS compliance? PCI DSS compliance is stand for Payment Card Industry Data Security System. Basically, if the vendor is PCI DSS compliance, meaning they will have safeguard measure here to protect your credit card information. Okay. Like in Shopee, what I do is I don't give them my credit card. What I do is I buy the credit. I want to play safe. Today they may tell me it's safe, but then somewhere along the line, you know, their business suffer, you know, my data is there, you know. I don't know how sure are they, when would they destroy. So what I do is that I put in like an e-wallet inside there. So if I got cash, I buy lah. I don't need to put in my credit card. That's one way you do it. Is it like Shopee? You can top up, right? Shopee Pay, something like that. So you can have credit inside. The same go for Lazada. So that I don't compromise unnecessarily the risk factor in using my credit card.
What about Facebook? Is it the same? What about the security level at Facebook?
Facebook security is not stringent. Okay, let me share with you. This is a real case.
Let's say we advertise in Facebook. So we need to put a credit card in the Facebook itself, Facebook US account. How safe is that?
Why do you need a credit card inside?
No, in case you do advertisement campaigns in Facebook, you advertise in Facebook, they need to charge you regularly.
Okay.
Because sometimes we have 5-6 campaigns running same time. Eh?
Okay, I understand that. Okay, if you go into Facebook, this is under Facebook business, okay?
Yes.
Inside the FAQ, they will have certain writing on the security aspect of credit card information. They are compliance to that. So they will take measure to safeguard the credit card information. Okay. So if you ask me how safe are they, no system is foolproof. That's why the director of FBI formally said that, you know, there are only two type of company. One that has been hacked, then the other one is ready to be hacked. So there's no system that is 100% foolproof one. Yes. The other way you can do is that, you know, you can have a credit card, okay, with a bank where your maximum limit, okay, to be charged is at maybe 3,000 ringgit. So at least your loss is mitigated to 3,000. So we need to be, you know, more diligent in this. If let's say you go Facebook, generally you can trust, yes, business. But you want to be double sure, you make sure you have a separate credit card, the limit you detect to the bank so that they can only charge up to this limit. So your loss is minimized to this amount only. That's what I will do. Anyone else?
Simon, I'm Partiban here.
Sorry?
Partiban.
Yes, Partiban.
Yeah. Actually, before this, I think in 2013 or 2014, actually we did encounter a cyber attack whereby our server was actually completely locked down. That means they've stolen all the files and they wanted us to pay the ransomware in a certain amount of fine. So we actually had a Norton antivirus as, you know, a protection shield. But unfortunately, I think the virus still managed to get through the server. But we are quite lucky that at that particular time, we managed to save some data. So we only, what we did is that we deleted whatever data that we had, which has been corrupted. And then we used the backup data. And even with the Norton antivirus that we have installed, we don't find that at that particular time in 2014 like that is that efficient. It didn't save us from you know, any cyber protection.
Mm-hmm.
So, another question that I have, I mean, this the first question is, which security platform is highly recommended? That's the first question.
Okay.
Second question is that since 2010, I bought a MacBook. So I'm still using that MacBook until now. And Tachut, all this while, of course, you know, we have accessed some of the junk emails, and, you know, sometimes it leads to websites and all, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I feel that MacBook has not have infected any of the files that I have in my system. But mm-hmm. If you go through working together with Windows, whatever it is, even you click by mistake or whatsoever, it tend to corrupt the data and files. So from your personal opinion, what do you think about the operating system? Which one do you prefer on the security level? Is iOS is much more better or Windows is much more better, even with the security platform?
Okay, good. Now, yeah. Let me answer your first question as to why, when you even have Norton antivirus installed, you still can get compromised. Now, let me share with you. Now, try to bear with me. You imagine a triangle, okay? There are three lines, okay? The bottom line, you put there 85% to 90%.
Mm-hmm.
The middle line, you put in 9%. The top line, you put 1%,
mm-hmm.
okay? Now, the third line, you see 85 to 90%. That one, most of the antivirus or anti-malware can protect you. But when it comes to the 9 and 1%, the 9% is called advanced persistent threat. That means there are another level of cybersecurity breach, and the 1% is targeted attack. Now, because of the compromise of the Eternal Blue hacking tools that is already linked into the market, the line between the 1% and the 9% is erased. Therefore, the one is above the 90% become targeted attack.
Mm-hmm.
So your Norton antivirus is probably can do the job for the just the bottom line, which is maximum up to 90%. So it can be anywhere between 60 to 90%. So Norton was developed by Symantec, okay? And they're no longer available, okay? It's meant for retail pack. So preferably, if you want a stronger antivirus, you go for those enterprise grade. How you know it's enterprise grade? Very simple. You go to Gartner Leadership Quadrant for EPP, Endpoint Protection. You see those a few brands down there for EPP. Those are more reliable and meant for enterprise grade. So you can use that as a guideline to help you purchase your antivirus.
Sorry, Simon, can you type on the chat box so that we can look at the chat box later?
I'm trying to find. Can you see Gartner Leadership Quadrant for Endpoint Protection?
All right.
Oh, Gartner Leadership Quadrant. Okay.
Yeah. Because there are four quadrants, you don't go all the... You don't need to look at the niche or, you know, you go for the leadership. That means they are the true leader in terms of a number of aspects of the... evaluation by Gartner.
Okay, so cool.
You will see the likes of Trend Micro and I think was there's a few there. Because this year they do an annual refresh. So there is a 2020 list, it should be the latest. Then in this year, then they will have a 2021. So from there, you can use this. A lot of CIO, in order to play safe, they will look at this leadership quadrant. They use that as a guideline. So I share with you some hints.
Okay. Next, anyone?
Sorry, the second question. The second question, I'm trying to recall.
Yeah, okay. The second question was, you see, as I told you, I was using MacBook, all this one.
Okay.
Windows.
Okay.
Yeah.
You were asking me which
platform? I mean, like you see, the operating system on the safety wise is better compared to.
Okay, let me share to you is that, you know, most of the cyber attack is targeting at the Windows platform, okay? Because simply because it is the most available in the market today. iOS is for iPhone and also for the Mac, okay? They are, in a way, less vulnerable. Let me share with you why I say that. Now, if you take iPhone and Android. Android, you need to download the apps from Play Store or Google, right? All those things. So, the security screening from this side is less robust. Now, for iOS, if you want to sell any of your application, you need to send to Apple so they will filter out, okay, your application in terms of its code and what to look for any vulnerabilities. So Apple will do that for you. So we, for those users who use iPhone, we have an added layer of security. That's why there are less incident on iOS phone as compared to Android. Okay, that's one. Second thing is also on desktop, okay, between the Windows desktop and the Mac desktop, we also see less incident on the Mac desktop simply because, you know, it may not be so lucrative lah, for cyber criminal to develop a malware just to hack onto Mac. But because the world, majority of the world users on desktop and PC, they are on Windows platform. That's why they are more prime. And probably there are more vulnerabilities in Windows OS, they call it as CVE, for them to go in for. So to answer you, yes, in a way, if you give me a choice between Mac and Windows, I will stay with Mac. Does that answer you?
Yes, sir. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much, Simon.
You're most welcome. Any question?
Simon, Subin here.
Yeah.
If you are the system administrator for a particular client, example, they outsource their IT services and protection to your company, Joss. Then if there is an attack, would you all be able to help them to resolve the attack, like fight it back? Or do you all do that? Or you all just give advice on how to protect your system?
Okay, there are two things to this. First thing is that the human resource, okay, where they will help you to analyze the type of attack. The other one is the cybersecurity solution in place in your organization. For example, okay, First thing is we do is to make sure that all the devices are installed with enterprise grade antivirus. That is your first line of defense.
Okay? Yeah.
And then those are to manage the so-called 90%. Now, for those more advanced one, it could be the APT targeted attack or even the what you call the ransomware. What we do is we can put in another layer of solution inside, okay, where we will detect this kind of thing before it happens so that we can kill it off. You understand?
I understand, Simon. Thanks. Okay. Because we got clients who don't have proper systems running when we promote the cyber risk insurance for them, security against intrusion and ransomware, hackware and all that. Mm-hmm. Some of them don't have a proper system or proper IT department as such.
Okay, in this case, actually, my best advice for them is that this organization should first thing do the step one procedure, whereby they should do a proper cybersecurity assessment. So when this assessment will study the environment, the infra, you know, and look for vulnerability in their system. So these are flagged up early, and then we can propose a solution to mitigate these gaps to bring it up to an acceptable level of security before you can insure them. Because otherwise, if you don't know your security posture, how are you going to defend it?
Correct.
Simple as that.
Okay. I'm going to talk to you and Steven another time.
No problem.
Thanks, Simon.
Most welcome, sir.
Okay, any more questions? Who's the others? Because otherwise I'll ask ourselves.
One thing I have to clearly agree with Simon. I mean, it's important that you keep yourself up to date. Assessments and scans is not a one-time thing, right? It has to be done regularly. First time, maybe it makes you aware what's going on in your network, in your infrastructure, but then it's important to keep this doing like a regular thing. It's like compared to your own health, right? It's not like you go to a doctor once and then you don't go back for the next 40 years. you do regular checkups. You want to make sure everything is in order. And I think that's something that JOS is offering and are the experts in the field. So I would really recommend getting back to Simon or also via Stephen. Get your stuff checked, your infrastructure, your environment. Make sure that you're safe and secure and keep it as an ongoing thing. That's
okay, good. I have a question. Just now, Simon, you presented halfway. You said that a malware may be residing in your corporate IT network for years, all right, without you knowing, and then siphoning information out, you know. This is very dangerous because anything going on is always been siphoned. How do we know there's such a thing going on in your company? What are the telltale signs? And second question, and what do we do? How do we resolve this problem? All right.
Okay. How do you know whether we have all these things? That is where the cybersecurity assessment comes in. It's basically an audit on the security level of your infra. That's the first thing. So normally from here, we will know your network, okay, whether it's clean or not, because they will put in a device that will run an agent to scout for this kind of vulnerability and compare it to the threat intel that is available in the market today, so that what is the latest thing is inside there or what is the malware is inside there. Okay, from there, then they can initiate a cleanup.
I see. That means other than the IT securities assessment, there's no other way end user can see. There's no telltale sign. All in the background.
Actually, you can. What you do is, like I said, that you remember the half onion theory I told you. You can implement a cybersecurity solution inside where, you know, besides on top of the so-called antivirus, you can put in the intrusion prevention system inside. Okay, basically, it's your perimeter security for your network that can scout and scan for any vulnerability within your network. Because cybersecurity solution is just not antivirus. There are many types to put in. They are all robust. There's one they call the IPS, which is intrusion prevention. There are also, so, you know, the servers that they run on OS, they need to have regular patches update, right? So Microsoft may issue once a month. But, you know, in between that, we even have solution that can do a virtual patching to momentarily secure you until you get the patches, the real patches fixed up. So there is also another solution called deep security, all right? Then the other one is called the DDI, the Deep Discovery Inspector. This, what is called a Deep Discovery Inspector is basically, is inside there to scout for all those zero-day malware, the APT, the targeted attack. So those are things that, you know, like I say, the security layers of protection is like a half onion. So you can increase your layer of protection. So depending on the business, if your business have a lot of dollar and cent trading, then it may make more sense, you know, besides putting in the antivirus, you have a, what you call the intrusion prevention solution in place so that it can monitor your network, okay? And also, that's on-prem, okay? And then, if you're having a service, it's good to have your virtual patching done, all right? And then you're afraid of those more advanced kind of malware, then it's good to put in solution like Deep Discovery Inspector so they can discover it. At the same time, some companies say, hey, I'm small, medium company. I don't want to have so many hassle this, because this one, you know, the more solution you put in, of course, it's all dollar and cents. So you can subscribe to our, what you call the Threat Intel Event Monitoring. This is basically a SaaS model whereby, you know, your traffic is pumped to our via VPN to our data center. Our server will run check against the list of threat intel to detect any vulnerabilities in your network. Once that is detected, we can alert you so that you can take action to remedy it, or you can get us to do it for you. So there are many solutions that we can play with. So it depends on the type of solution you're looking at, the budget, and also what kind of protection you require. So it's good that we can sit down, you know, we analyze what is your environment about. For example, like you have companies that want to do with shares trading. So they do securities, so-called, they call share security. Some of them, they churn out every Friday a report. So they don't allow their staff to carry handphone, the notebook, no thumb drive, so they cannot copy all this kind of information out. They used to outsource the printing of this so-called report to external party until they found that some people from the printer took this report to sell to make extra money. So then they do it in-house. So when they do in-house, they also need to know there's a reviewer who come up with this report. When they send it over, they make sure they send to one source of a printer that can securely print it. So those kind of things is different solution altogether as compared to other industries.
Wow, interesting.
Yeah. I got a lot of story one. If I tell 2 days, also won't finish. Any more questions?
Yeah, if no more questions, or let's say if more questions, then I think anytime can reach out to Stephen or Simon. I would say, well, you let me know what is your preferred way. I first of all would like to thank you. Thank also Joss for taking this session and doing a very informative and insightful session today. And as Simon said, security is a huge topic. Goes from endpoints to perimeter to infrastructure to awareness also. So a lot of stuff to really know. And as you said, also better to leave it to the experts if something happens, or better before something happens, make sure you're well protected. Better be safe than sorry, as we say. So if you want to let us know how to reach out to you.
I will put it here. HTWong@joss.com. You got it?
Oh, okay.
But
you put in a chat group, can see.
Yeah.
HTWong, right?
Yeah.
Okay, at joss.com.
Yeah.
Good.
Well, you can call Steven. I think Steven, you all know, right? Very well, right?
Maybe, Steven, yeah.
Maybe they are shy with me, but not shy with Steven.
Famous face in this on course.
So I think what I will do here is actually later I will share Simon and my business card in the business on course chat room. So okay. That will be more complete, right?
I truly want to express that I'm impressed with this, because I think Simon, you come across as someone who is very experienced in this. In fact, you have a lot more that you have not enough time to present here, I think. Your years of experience in cybersecurity. So I must say that, first of all, I'd like to thank Stephen Su for taking up this opportunity, favor to present to all of us so that we are more aware of what's going on in the market. And Simon also, Simon Wong, Josh Malaysia, both of you, Hong Kong Business Network, Josh Malaysia, right? So I'd like to thank both of you for the time here, and Patrick for being a fantastic moderator today. And I'd like to thank all the Visa course members for attending to make this possible. So I look forward to see all of you. And guys, if any of you have any more questions on cybersecurity, I think you know where to look, okay? Sometimes when you are in such a sensitive situation, you don't know who is the right person to turn to always, you ask around. But now here's in front, you can see Stephen Su, and also Simon Wong of HKBN, Josh Malaysia. All right, thank you. Thank you, all of you. So, Patrick. Sure. Thanks a lot. Have a great evening. And let's hope that we can see Jarvis soon on the golf course. else probably next month first on another webinar that we will be organizing. Thanks for joining. The next webinar coming up middle of next month will be alternative financing for your business and projects. So there's one gentleman who owns a company in a Biz on Course member that can allow members to look at other alternative funding for their business or project other than banking, other than the usual way. So this is interesting. So I look forward to see all of you next month. Okay, thank you.
Perfect. Thanks, Daniel. All thanks, right. Guys. Have a great day.
Thank you, Daniel.
Thank you, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Thank you, Stephen, Simon.
Yeah,
okay, you're welcome, Stephen. Yeah.